Rules Committee come to order, and thank you very much for joining us this evening. Before we get to our work for the dean, I'd like to take a moment to celebrate the life of ranking member of the committee, my dear friend Louise Slaughter, who last week passed away. As you all know, Louise passed away on Friday evening. She leaves behind a legacy of service and deep love of country that I think each of us seek to emulate, each of us as we do our duty not only to our district, but the duty to this body and the duty to the Constitution. Come to this body and do, I think, amazing things. Louise was one of those. She fiercely led. She did it with loyalty to her constituents from Rochester, New York. And she brought her ideas to Washington, D.C. to make sure that they were represented. Louise made history, and I would refer you to the back wall at this point where we are honoring Louise, not only to cherish her memory, but to cherish her life. She broke down barriers by serving as the first female chairwoman of the House Rules Committee. As her port was hung in the room, I was there to relish the moment, not only with her family, but constituents, staff, and many others who saw her legacy and her life as being important to all Americans, not just those from Rochester. She believed that anything was possible, and she could fight for it. She always spoke fondly and passionately to young Americans, many times as they were in this room, but also other times as I saw her throughout the Capitol. No doubt her influence has been counted on to help others in their life, not only with respect and dignity, but a spirit that really was pretty interesting. I cherished her friendship, and I'll miss her. Her camaraderie was second to none. And of course, her famous rhubarb pie was enjoyed by all. She was a friend to every member of this committee. She treated all witnesses with respect. She was important not just to this committee, but also her staff on both sides of the aisle. We're going to miss her. I'm going to miss her. Not only her wit, her fire, her leadership, and I think most importantly, the kindness and cordiality that she brought to everybody she came into contact with. I've had the immense privilege of working side by side with her for 20 years, and I considered her a partner, and we worked together. She's a dear friend, and I'm going to miss her, but we're also going to celebrate her on a regular basis. I intend to speak about her, just as we talked about Bob, as she spoke about Bob. She remembered her husband well. He left a mark on her and a mark on us. She did too. I don't act like I was on her team. I act like that we worked together. She was fierce. She was a fierce competitor. I admired that. Her service on behalf of the entire Rules Committee was of service to this Congress. It was of service to her party and of service to our nation. I will continue to offer my prayers and sympathy for her family, for the staff, for this body. Don't have to make it up when it fits. Everybody recognized it. They knew it for what it was when she came to work, what she stood for, how she lived her life, and the kind of person she is and was. We're going to speak at some point about the opportunity to join her in a service that I believe will be this Friday. It's not been completely finalized, but whenever it is, I will be there. I'd like to yield now to the gentleman, the ranking member, for any opening comment he'd like to make, and I thank the gentleman for his insistence that we remembered Louise openly throughout this time and speak about her with praise and celebration of her life. And I appreciate him and other members of this committee as they express ideas about her. And I want to thank you. Gentleman's recognized.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for your very kind and generous words about our colleague Louise. And I think I speak for everybody on this panel when I say we're going to miss her. She was an incredible woman. She had a heart bigger than Kentucky and New York combined, but she also had a spine of steel. She cared deeply about things, and she fought hard for things. She never gave up on anything or anyone she believed in. I think we all appreciated her candor, her collegiality, and her compassion. With Louise, you never had to wonder where you stood on an issue. If she was with you, you felt the love. If she was against you, you had to back away because she fought hard for what she believed in. And that really kind of is a great part of her legacy. I think her constituents and all the causes that she championed benefited from her persistence. I said last week, I said, the world is going to miss Louise. I already do. Mr. Chairman, one of the great things Louise did is she assembled, I think, some of the finest staff anywhere on Capitol Hill. They together wrote a statement on behalf of all of them that I would like to read with your permission.
Yes, sir.
This is a statement of the Democratic staff on the House Rules Committee regarding the loss of Ranking Member Louise McIntosh Slaughter. Louise was our boss, mentor, leader, and our chairwoman and our friend. She taught us when to ask, when to push, and when to fight like hell. In her case, she usually preferred to fight like hell. But while doing so, she was always armed with her unmatched Southern charm. It was her charm and intellect that allowed her to teach us that language is a form of art. And while the right words are required at all times, the perfect words are what make life more interesting. Of their importance, she would often say, and I quote, scholars and historians will read these words, will read these words someday. It has to be right, end quote. But Louise never used words to simply convey the facts. She painted the most animated picture with her language, using phrases that almost shook the listener. For example, to express that the rules in the Senate are arcane and confusing, Louise said, you would think that the Red Queen from Alice in Wonderland wrote the rules over there. She once said getting anything done in Congress was as hard as docking the Queen Mary by hand. And rather than say, I don't fully understand this issue, she would much prefer, I know more about turning rocks into gold than I do about this. We're going to have to dig in deeper here. Louise also taught us that time is precious. She acted with urgency, knowing she would not be here forever, while somehow at the same time living like her life would never end. There was one certainty. As long as that woman could breathe and move, she would work. She worked through illness, diabetes, a broken leg, the loss of her husband of 57 years, and probably countless ailments that she powered through in private. She refused wheelchairs and canes to show no hints of weakness, a condition Louise McIntosh Slaughter of Harlan County, Kentucky, never knew. A lot has been said this week about her legislative accomplishments, which are too many to count. But what we will miss most is her charm, her sense of humor, and the way she brought limitless passion and love to this job and to our lives. Some of us on the staff started working here just a few weeks ago, and in that short time, we could already see what a force of nature she was. Some of us spent countless hours by her side during votes and committee meetings, often very late at night, struggling while she looked wide awake at 3 a.m., powered only by the virtue of her beliefs and a cup of black coffee. And a few among us have known Louise for most of our adult lives, growing up from junior staff to become her most senior advisors. We learned so much from our boss and appreciated it every time she pretended to learn from us. You know, working in this building for this woman has been the privilege and honor of a lifetime. We are deeply grateful for the kind words from all over the country and from members of this committee in particular. We appreciate the kindness that the chairman always showed Louise, and she did too. And we are also so thankful to our remaining members for stepping up to fill the void and for their comforting words and actions, reminding us what wonderful people we work with. But make no mistake, the loss for our committee, for this House, and for our country is profound. While this tragedy is a deep wound for all of us and shocking in its suddenness, we will follow Louise's example and carry on with our work no matter how hard it is. And I want to thank the staff for putting this together, and I know Louise is watching from above and very proud of each and every one of them. So I thank the chairman. I yield back.
Mr. Montgomery, thank you very much. The call that I received from the staff director, Mr. Session, the other morning was one of pain, but I know it was more on Don and the staff than anyone. And as we would watch Louise come and go, I was always, perhaps some of the best moments might be up here when we did do our job, but they were also downstairs when I would visit her. And she was always warm and genuine and in her own court, so to speak, with confidence, with enthusiasm, and always with ideas. And there wasn't one time when I would not present her with one thing that she would say, okay, and let's remember this other thing. And Don, I want to say that her confidence and love of you was deep and profound. And those other young people who are in this staff, don't forget how important words are, missions are, and life is. You will move throughout your life, but this will be a void. And I so much appreciate the way your staff has handled her also, because to the very end, she was important to you. And that tells me a lot about you, too. So, Don, thank you for accepting my words of support also. And as we move forward this week, next week, whatever it might be, we're here to make sure that we are part of trying to do this right. So, thank you very much. Judge Hastings, do you wish time?
Very briefly, Mr. Chairman. I had the good fortune of knowing Louise and Robert for all of my career here, and had the good fortune to travel with them abroad. Often she encouraged me to become a member of the Helsinki Commission. She was there before me, and she side by side assisted me in becoming president of the Parliamentary Assembly of the Organization for Security in Europe. Mr. Chairman, like all of us, I was overcome with sadness by the tragic news of the passing of our dear friend and esteemed colleague, who was not only the ranking member of this committee, but first and only woman to have chaired the committee. For 30 years, Louise poured every ounce of energy she had into serving her constituents in upstate New York. She never hesitated, as Jim has said, to speak her mind, and she never wavered in espousing her beliefs. I'll always be very grateful for the time that I had to serve alongside her. Last week, none of us would have expected the suddenness of this tragedy. But we were here, and I wasn't feeling well, and it's so ironic how life has its twists and turns. And the last thing that she said to me was, Elsie, take care of yourself. Mm-hmm. I promise her that I will do that. Louise was one of my greatest friends in Congress, having not only served, as I've indicated here, on this committee with her for all the years that I've been on the committee, but also throughout the Congress's activities. told a lady yesterday who didn't know Louise about the extraordinary work that she did, and she was a microbiologist, and my college graduate was in biology, and she and I talked about a number of things. But one of the things I hope that we continue was her effort to make sure that we dealt with foodborne illnesses in this country. She was a champion, as all of us on this committee know, in that regard. Her legacy speaks for itself. She was not just a champion for women's rights. She was a champion of working families everywhere. And this nation has lost one of our fiercest public servants, and her absence is going to leave an unavoidable void. I particularly am appreciative of the staff comments, which capture a lot of her essence. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to offer my deepest condolences to Louise's daughters, Megan Sakatora, Amy Slaughter, and Emily Minerva, her seven grandchildren and one great-grandson, as well as to her friends, constituents, and congressional staff during this extremely difficult time. Louise's spirit and loving memory will always live in the halls of Congress. She will be dearly missed. We should be comforted by the fact that she joins her beloved Robert Slaughter, and that's how she would refer to him often. All of us are saddened, and just as a point of levity, which Louise would expect from me, we could really do her proud on this committee by making our weak rules be ones with open rules. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Judge Hastings, thank you very much. It would be her wish, I'm sure.
Yeah.
The gentleman from Colorado.
Thank you. You know, Luis has been a great mentor to me since I came to Congress almost 10 years ago. And, you know, I always just, I can't even imagine a Congress without Luis. She was here long before me, and this is my final year. I thought she'd be here long after me. So this is just comes as a great surprise. I when I first showed up and we were in the majority, I sat where Ms. Cheney is now, and Luis really taught me the ropes of the Rules Committee, everything from at that point in the majority, never voting against a rule, to being able to handle myself on the floor. And her amazing, insightful wit, her character, are really just a credit to this committee and this institution. I particularly want to highlight that she also was somebody that was ahead of her time in many ways. She was a firm believer in science. She was one of only 67 members in 1996 to vote against the Defense of Marriage Act. She always stood for LGBT equality. A woman who grew up in Kentucky of that era, that was amazingly forward-looking. And in many ways, I give her even more credit for her progressive, forward-looking views than if she'd grown up in San Francisco or in New York. As you know, she studied microbiology. She went on to have a career at Procter & Gamble. And she got involved in the community, like so many of us before we decided to run for office. People just started suggesting to her at a time when not a lot of women were in this institution. And she overcame the odds and was elected. And not only that, rose to the height of being the first woman ever to chair the powerful Rules Committee. So I, throughout my life, it'll be a great honor to have called her a mentor, a friend, a source of inspiration. And I look forward to honoring her memory and Bob's memory, who, as we all know, used to attend our committee meetings, especially late at night when we were here, 10, 11 o'clock. I would also add at those meetings, 10, 11 o'clock, we had some at 12:30, 1 o'clock. I was always tired, you know, somewhat disheveled, but somehow Louise looked as bright as the morning dew and ready to go, even if we were here at 1 in the morning. I never quite figured out her secret, but her stamina is truly legend. And I, for one, have benefited tremendously from having known the amazing Louise McIntosh Slaughter, and I yield back.
Thank you very much. You know, gifts, she made friends with things that were hard. She had gifts. I mean, God gave her so many gifts, not just the ability to get up and do things at 3 in the morning, but I don't know that she's ever said a nasty or negative thing about even hard things. I think she took them on, and these were some of the gifts you all are in reference to. The gentlewoman from Wyoming.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I knew Louise for the shortest period of time, probably of just about everybody in this room, and I am tremendously, I feel tremendously blessed even to have known her for that short period of time, and to have had the chance to watch her up close, and to have had the chance to learn from her. As you all know better than I do, there were many, many times sitting here when Louise would start to say something and you would think, you know, this is going to be a softball. And then all of a sudden, you know, would come the toughest question, the biggest zinger. And she always did it. It was that combination that Jim mentioned of tremendous intellect, tremendous competence, diligence. She knew the issues and charm. And it was incredibly effective. And she just kept fighting. And I was just feel very blessed that I've had the opportunity to watch her firsthand. In particular, as a woman, it was nice to have another woman up here on the panel. And she's somebody that provided lessons for all of us, so men and women alike, in terms of how to conduct yourself and how to have disagreements, policy disagreements, in a way that remains civil. And I always appreciated that, and I'll always remember and feel very grateful that I had the opportunity to serve with her. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. The gentleman from Colorado.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just briefly, I wanted to say that Louise Slaughter taught me how to be a member of Congress. She had such grace and compassion. She if you saw how she interacted with other members, if you saw how she interacted with constituents and staff, she was just a great role model for newer members to Congress. And I just really, when you called me the other day, really saddened that members who will be joining this body in the future won't have a role model like that to see and to follow. So I yield back.
Thank you very much. The gentleman from the state of Washington.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And it's a sad honor to join my colleagues in talking about our friend Louise. you know, a lot of the things we talk about in this room are become kind of heated, and certainly we disagree on a lot of different points, and no one that I know in here is shy about expressing their feelings on things, and certainly Louise was not. But she also demonstrated that personal relationships can transcend political relationships. I counted her truly as a friend, and from day one, she reached out to me to extend her hand of friendship, and I really appreciated that. Invited me into her office and told me some about the history of all the things that had happened in there over the centuries. And not that she was there to know that for sure, but she had knowledge of what was going on and had happened way back to when the British burned the Capitol, and it was really interesting. But probably the biggest thing that she and I connected on, and I hope none of you ever have to experience this, but she and I were members of an exclusive club. We had both lost our spouses, and she took it upon herself to, in every opportunity, make sure I was doing okay. And we exchanged books, Somehow she had me thinking I was helping her through the loss of her husband, when in fact, being much smarter than I, was kind of had a reverse effect, and through my attempt to help her, I was really helping myself. I just always appreciated her reaching out and her kind of taking me under, so to speak, her wing, even though I was of the wrong party. Very saddened to get your phone call last week. It doesn't seem as though it's even possible that there's just a bouquet of flowers in front of her chair. Thanks for giving us the opportunity to express ourselves.
Thank the gentleman from Georgia.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. When I got your call and I was driving, and I was just thinking for a moment, it reminded me of this committee in particular and the hours that we keep and the things that we do and back and forth, but it also reminded me that each and every one of us behind whatever party affiliation we have or wherever we represent, there's a reminder of our humanity. There's a reminder that there's a bigger place than even this place that we all value so much. I remember Louise just in being here on this committee and watching her, and she always just had a way of, no matter what you were thinking, if you walked in, I remember she'd be here sometimes early and I'd walk in and she'd look over at me, she had that big grin, and she'd just wave at me, just completely disarmed at that point. And I'll never forget the last time I had the privilege of standing across on the floor of the House debating a rule with her. I walked over and we were both sort of tired. It was time to get out. I went over and asked her. I come up on her and she didn't see me come up, so I laid my hand on the back of her shoulder and I said, "How many speakers are you going to have today?" She said, "I don't know, but I'm cold. I want to get out of here." She just had a way of doing the job, but also knowing at the same time about people around her. When I told my wife, we both remembered in her kindness that she had. It's often been said, and there's a proverb that says that all of us, it's a Chinese proverb, says we're all like chalk, that everywhere we go, we leave a mark. And for this boy from Georgia, the young lady from Kentucky left a mark. And that is something I will carry with me. With that, I yield back.
Thank you very much. The gentleman from Louisville, Texas, Dr. Michael Burgess.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I want to thank Mr. McGovern for sharing the thoughts of your staff, Democratic staff. I know Louise was one who was revered and revered the staff. And I think that was important to have that sentiment expressed today. We're all feeling their pain as well. So thank you, and thanks to the Democratic staff for putting pen to ink and making those thoughts available to the rest of the world. I think that was important that those things were said. So thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Thank you very much, Dr. Burgess, the gentleman from Georgia.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I didn't return your call on Saturday. I got your message, and by the time I got it, I knew why you were calling. And there's something that makes it a little more official when somebody picks up the phone and tells you. I didn't want to hear it. I heard from my mom a short time later. You all don't know my mother, but she's not from Harlan County, Kentucky, but she has the same spirit that Louise has. She'll tell you exactly how it is, and I'll just tell you, gentlemen, she does not always have kind words to say about you all when we're on the House floor together. But she knew how I felt about Louise. She heard and sent me a note saying she was feeling all of our pain. Made it real. I like telling Louise's story because it makes me feel good that a Southerner's so talented that those New Yorkers need somebody like that to represent them here in Congress. I've always believed that was a powerful testimony, but the truth is, first thing she said to me when I joined in that big class of four freshmen in 2011 was, "Rob, it's not too late to get out while you can." I bring all the young children, the daughters and the granddaughters who come to visit my office, and I have them sit in Louise's chair and look up there at the wall at the first woman to ever chair the Rules Committee and talk about how an indomitable spirit can lead to absolutely anything at all. I'm not sad to see Louise and Bob together again. The truth is, time plays tricks on you, and I still think about Bob sitting back there on the back row and them sharing that late night smile. But I am sorry that we're not going to have that force in our lives, and that we're not going to have that model for the young women in our lives. And the truth is, we're not going to have that model for the old men like me and you, Mr. Chairman, in our lives. And we all know that she made us better. She promised she was going to bring the Hickey Freeman folks down one last time to have a suit fitting for us all. I wore my absolute rattiest suit that I have today. My staff pointed it out earlier. She would find me when I was looking good, and she would find me when I was looking not so good. And she said, Rob, you know that in New York we have an American-made suit that even on your worst day will make you feel better. I'm going to find that Hickey Freeman company. I'm going to buy my Louise Slaughter suit, and I'm not just going to have that picture on the wall to remind me. I'm going to feel good about myself when I put it on, and I'm going to feel good about myself the way I did when she'd seek me out and try to lift me up instead of tear me down, and I'm grateful to her for that. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much. I'd like for us to take a minute, offer our own suggestion as she would choose. I'm going to offer a quick prayer to myself, and I'll let you do that to yourself. Thank you. Thank you. My prayer was for, in particular, the young people that are here, that they will remember and see the strength and courage, grace and charm, spit and fire, but never to give and never yield. And I hope that that's something that each of you will carry on for some period of time. Without objection, I'd like to add, if I can, to the record, New York Times article, as well as my press release about what Louise meant to me. We'll enter that into the record. If anybody else has anything else during the day, I encourage us to leave it for awesome stenographers.